one of the things that I've sometimes noticed in community forums is that somebody comes in a forum, as Steve Levine always puts it, he says that certain OS2 users live in caves. They sometimes come out and are amazed that something has happened. Or last year, in 2016, there was a presentation done at Warpstock, and somebody, after 10 years after Serenity Systems had disappeared, asked, whatever happened to Serenity Systems? I go like, yeah, this. Could you flip the slide, please? We don't have any sort of a remote control tool. Where did the idea originally come from? You've got TeamViewer and Copilot for remote control. These are tools that you can even use for non-commercial usage, but there's nothing on OS2. I heard some people contact the company if it ported to OS2. Chance of that happening, zilch. And if they do want to do it, you need to put a whole bunch of money on the table. It's not worth it. Windows even, you probably, if you've ever used, for example, the network connectivity wizard in Windows, if accessing files or printers doesn't work, this useless wizard comes up and it starts running. And if you go through all of the menu screens, at the end of it, it says, ask a friend for help. But that's also one of these remote control solutions that they built into the OS. So anyway, NetOp for OS2 can also no longer be purchased. It's gone. But it also had a small technical drawback, which I'll get back onto the next slide. You also had some other software like Copycat. These are all remote control tools that were available for OS2. The only downside is they either had a weak encryption or they had simply no encryption. Well, and as you might understand in today's bugged world, you don't want to use a unencrypted connection anymore. If you do, that's your own choice, but you know, it could be anybody from the Russians, the North Koreans, or the American NSA, or your own secret service that's tapping your data. It's simply not professional. Could you flip the slide, please? Yes. The font.
Yeah, the font. It's right.
Yes, I know. What?
It's all crunches together, so we were just wondering.
Yeah, it's the standard font that was in one of the OpenOffice presentation templates. I know Alex Taylor would kill me for the font selection.
Yes.
If you would have seen his presentation at Warpstock US about fonts, then you know if there's one thing that you can agitate Alex with, it's incorrect font selection. This will probably count. I'll probably end up in his gallery of ugly examples.
Maybe we should take a picture for
him. Go ahead, publish it. Maybe he will have some. Anyway. The other grievances that I sometimes have in the community, you know, it's just like going to the doctor. There's somebody that hasn't used OS2 for a couple of years. He comes into the forum, he does an installation, and he says, it doesn't work. Ah, where's the firing squad? Seriously, if you want to have help from somebody, and then there's a portion of the users that then step in and say, okay, well, can you explain to me how it's working? And sometimes it's so long and painful to finally get them to tell what they are seeing on the screen and explaining to you in a forum 1,000 kilometers away. Some of these people, by the way, think that you have that you have paranormal special gift, that you can look remotely on their screen. But then after a whole long time of talking, you finally start to figure out what's wrong. Wouldn't it be much easier for that person and for people in the community who want to provide support that they could simply say, you know what, here's a tool. If you have an internet access working on your computer, download it. The package would be about a megabyte in size. It has all of the required DLLs in it. It has the remote IP address specified in it of the site, me in this case, providing the support. He clicks on it and poof. We get a VNC access to his system. There are other ways of getting remote support, but how many people here in the room know how to set up a port forward in a router? Probably. Yeah. Now ask the same thing in a forum. There are probably a lot more people here knowledgeable on doing that. I think a rough estimate, 50% of the people raised their hand. So that's the other problem. But even if you could do that, we do have VNC server for OS2. Now, recently, Digi from Russia did make a version with, I think, that has encryption built in. But VNC in the past has been so fragile that you don't want to open up your PC and do a port forward to the IP address and then wait for me to walk in to provide support. So could you flip the slide, please? Okay, SSH, we probably all heard of that. That's a tool to remotely log onto a Linux server. That's what most people use it for. But you can also use SSH to transport data through it, and you can use it as an encrypted tunnel. It's basically a VPN budget solution. You don't need to install any drivers with the network stack. It just starts up SSH and it makes a connection. What Rich Walsh has been working on for me in Voice is a little package that that will start on the user's remote system. It will unpack in a temp directory. It will unpack EMX DLL, the SSH package, and the VNC server. The user can then, in a warp-in package, click through it, and then it will say that it's connecting. On my side, it will pop up a password window. I can type in the password, and then I can access his computer. Some of the benefits: no port forwards have to be set up on the other user's side. It's a 1 megabyte package. In theory, it should even be capable of running on a Warp 3 box, if necessary, because it has all of the required software built in, so you don't need to download a whole bunch of DLLs and other software applications or add stuff to the config sys. So it's very portable. And where do you get a remote download package that's about 1 megabyte in size? So you could even do it on a dial-up. Whether VNC will work correctly over dial-up, but let's find out. Until recently, I know that David Yeo from the United States was still on a dial-up modem because he was in a he's in a remote area of the United States. But he now got a 3G connection, which I understood from his email postings was a revelation for him, because he finally had something which was quicker than 56 kilobit. Who still has a modem here?
Oh, I even have a 12.
You're still on a dial-up connection.
Oh, about like that on the shelf. That's what was that?
The good news.
1.0.
No. In fact, I don't want to buy anything because Jeroen still has a couple of these old bricks in the cupboard as a monument. Oh, one. Okay. The other last benefit of this package is, now that Arkanoa has got a bootable USB stick that you can make, this package can also be placed on that stick. And the ArkaOS bootable stick also automatically recognizes your network card if it has a driver for it on board. It automatically goes out onto the local network and starts the DHCP client and see if it can get an IP address. So that means that I could send Edward the package that has my IP address in it. He puts it on his USB stick on the system that's failing. He boots up the system. He goes to a command line, types help desk, and on my side, it then pops up. Could you flip it to the next slide, please? I want to make this package available free of charge to the community. We're not charging a penny for it, but I was just getting so annoyed by these everlasting threads where somebody says it doesn't work, but then it takes so much effort to try and get him to describe what he's seeing on his screen and why he's come to the conclusion that it's failing. So it would be much easier. On top of that, if that customer has a bootable USB stick, it's much easier that if, for example, he screwed something up on his system or his hard disk is damaged, that you can at least do some form of a remote diagnostic. Because again, if you're stuck behind the keyboard and he's your only source of input, it's sometimes much easier if somebody can go in on the system and look at it why it's failing. Who will be using it? I'll be providing support. I'll be advertising that on the Voice website. It will, of course, be done on a best effort basis. So I'm not going to spend hours a week on that, but I don't have a problem with it. heck, for the last couple of years, there is, I think, a support page on the Voice website that had my old phone number on it, but I've never received an email. So I'd hope that other people in the forums would be willing to use this tool as well to help some of the people that enter the forums and are using OS2 again, that there finally is a solution. Have you ever seen these long, everlasting discussions where people try to update Warp 4 boot floppies by hand? If you've seen them, yeah, you've probably seen them. And it's painful. Set copy from floppy is one. Copy the correct drivers, the correct loader version, etc. We can provide some remote support. Some enhancements I would like to include are, for example, file transfer. Would be very handy, for example, if I could run DFC on the customer system and then I can push the data back to my system. Something like TeamViewer or Copilot has that facility. The other thing that's currently not built in is something of a chat feature. It's just VNC to get access to the remote desktop. So you'd have to use something like IRC or over the phone and then log in. Yeah, Skype, but that can probably run on any device. Okay, what I've done is I've made a very crude setup. That's what made it last slightly longer. I'm going to hook that up, and I'm just going to give you a brief demo of what it looks like.